Hello again, it's time to talk about some critiques of fiscal stimulus. And we're going to start out with crowding out theory. Now, remember from our previous lectures on fiscal policy, fiscal stimulus policy involves increasing government spending to replace a decline in private spending, to boost aggregate demand, to increase employment and growth in the economy. The question arises is, where does the money come from? Okay. Well, remember what Keynes said to Roosevelt: you want to finance this increased government spending with loans, with deficits, and not with taxation. Why? Well, if you raise taxes, you would just reduce consumption and investment spending, offsetting any aggregate demand stimulus effect of the higher government spending. Okay. And this is what we call the crowding out effect. And if you raise taxes to finance fiscal stimulus, it would be counterproductive. It would crowd out the additional spending. It would increase government spending only by reducing consumption and investment, private sector spending, and would have no net effect. It would have no overall stimulative effect. So crowding out is directly, and I hope obviously, applicable to tax-financed increase in government spending. Okay, and that's why Keynes says you want to do your fiscal stimulus with deficits, with borrowed money, not with increasing taxes. Fiscal policy implies deficits, don't forget. That's my big theme for this whole unit. Again, though, we want to ask the question, where does the money come from? Where does the government borrow from? The government does not have special access to the Bank of Mars. Okay, the government does not have special access to a magic money tree. When the government borrows, it goes to the same credit markets that any other borrowing entity in the economy goes to, right? And if the government's borrowing more of a given pool of financial capital available to borrow, that implies that other private entities have less to borrow. Crowding out theory still might be applicable to deficit-financed fiscal stimulus, just like it is to tax-financed fiscal stimulus. To give you an idea of how this works, we're going to take a look at the credit market, and this is pretty standard, supply and demand. Here's the demand for credit. Okay, now the demand, let me just kind of illustrate what it is. This is business demand to borrow. We could also talk about consumption borrowing, but we'll focus on business borrowing right now. To borrow to finance capital investment. The supply is the savings that people put into the credit markets, whether it's banks, the bond market, and various other financial intermediaries. Okay, and we're going to envision a situation where we've got a normal functioning credit market, we've got an equilibrium interest rate. Okay, remember, the price of borrowing, the price you have to pay to borrow is an interest rate, the price you earn for saving is an interest rate, and we'll say we've just got an equilibrium interest rate and an equilibrium quantity of loanable funds. That's what the LF stands for. So Q star and I star at an initial equilibrium. Now, what's going to happen when the government steps in to borrow a lot of money? You want to think about this. Government wants to borrow more. Okay, is that on the demand side or the supply side? That's clearly on the demand side. Okay, the government is going to step in to borrow money to do fiscal stimulus. What happens? So we're going to model it like this. It's going to shift the demand curve to the right. I'm going to label this D plus government deficit. Okay. Government borrowing adds to private sector borrowing, and it shifts the total demand curve out and to the right like this. Okay. Well, normal effect here from supply and demand says that that's going to drive interest rates up, because we're going to increasing demand, holding supply constant, we're going to increase the quantity supplied at a higher price. Okay. So quantity shifts out to the right, and the price, or the interest rate, goes up like this. Okay. So the question is, can the government borrow more? Yes. Okay. Where are they getting the money? Well, let's go back to the initial demand curve, which doesn't change. We're just adding to it. Okay, we're adding on top of, it's a different color here, we're adding on top of that initial demand curve, but the underlying business, private sector demand stays the same here. And notice that the higher interest rate, if that demand curve didn't shift, we just added to it. What's going to happen at a higher interest rate for private borrowing is they're going to climb back up their demand curve. They're going to retreat up their demand curve. We're going to have a quantity demand shift down here. So private borrowing shifts like this, and I'll label this quantity private sector, shifts down from the initial equilibrium in order for government borrowing to increase. Okay, so this increase right here, this is the government borrowing component. Government can borrow more only by forcing private sector, PS right here, to borrow less. Okay, in other words, the government borrowing has crowded out private borrowing. And when we go back and think about this, well, one more element that we want to recognize here is that what happens in order for the government to increase total borrowing in the credit market, well, what they're going to do again is force savers up the quantity saved. Okay? Quantity saved is going to increase. They're going to force savers up the supply curve. Okay? So what we have is an increase in savings. Let me summarize what's going on here. Results of government borrowing. We've got higher saving, quantity saved technically. We've got lower private sector borrowing. And if we're I'm focusing here on business demand, so that's going to be lower investment because businesses borrow to invest. So lower private sector borrowing and investment, higher interest rates in order to increase government borrowing. Think in terms of y equals c plus I plus g. We're doing an increase in government borrowing so government spending can go up, deficit financed government stimulus. Go back here and realize the first result of government borrowing is higher savings. Higher saving by definition means what? Lower consumption. Go back here again, we realize that there's lower private sector borrowing and investment. Private sector investment is down. What's going on? In order for government spending to increase here, private sector consumption and investment spending decreased. What we have is yet again crowding out. So what this theory implies is that even if you do deficit financed stimulus, crowding out still applies, or still can apply, we should say, still can apply. Now, in what circumstances would crowding out not apply to deficit spending? Well, want to go back and think about those elements that were necessary for fiscal policy to make sense, which is you have a lot of idle resources and idle cash in the economy, and you have aggregate demand shock, and you have a decline in investment demand, and you have an increase in saving. Okay, and what we're looking at is a situation where if there's a decrease in investment demand and an increase in savings, there's going to be low interest rates and a bunch of idle financial resources. There's going to be a low opportunity cost. In other words, there's a bunch of money just sitting around not doing anything anyway, so there's nothing for the government to crowd out when the government steps in to borrow. Okay, business investment demand is down. Government can step in and borrow up these funds without much crowding out, without much of a opportunity cost. And back to the supply and demand framework, I'll show you what we're looking at here. We start with an initial level of business demand like this. Demand, okay, label this business. Demand for business, investment, supply, which is total savings that's channeled credit markets and the financial system. Now, think about what's happening in a recession, especially an aggregate demand shock recession. Is business investment high? No, it's low, it's way down, which means that demand has shifted. Businesses are much less willing to invest and therefore much less willing to pay to borrow funds. So investment demand is going to be way down here. I'll label this D prime, depression level of demand. And what might be happening with savings at the same time? Now this might be a little more ambiguous, but we think about savings as increased potentially. I'll label this S prime. This is due to the fear and uncertainty effects. People holding more cash, holding more money. It technically doesn't necessarily imply lower interest rates if they're not keeping it in the banking system. Okay, so that can be an ambiguous effect, but either way, we'll notice here that we're going to see interest rates be pushed down in this scenario, in this aggregate demand shock depression. Whether it's just a demand effect, we shifted the demand curve here and that pushes interest rates down. Actually, let's label that I star. This would be I prime. And then if we also do have that increased savings effect, we'll label this I double prime. Okay, interest rates are low. Okay. And interest rates low interest rates signals that there's a lot of capital available to be borrowed and there's not a lot of demand for it. Okay. So that might be a situation in which government can step in and do a lot of borrowing without much offset, if any at all. Okay. So crowding out's not not necessarily going to be applicable. You want to look at what happens to interest rates. And the Keynesians will say, look, if interest rates are low, crowding out's probably not relevant. Now, if interest rates are high and rising, yes, crowding out's relevant. If they're low, crowding out's probably not relevant. What's the current level of interest rates? Well, you can see here, interest rates, we're talking short-term rates. There's the Fed funds rate basically at zero. Here's 30-year mortgage rates down at 3.5, lower than they've pretty much ever been. We could look at 10-year government bond rates around 2%, okay, 30-year government bond rates around 3.5%. Interest rates are basically lower than they've ever been. Now, short-run rates, that's because of the Fed standard monetary policy. Long-run rates, that has a little to do with Fed policy. That has mostly to do with supply and demand in the credit market. So we are, it looks like we are in that situation right now. So there is this opening for the government to borrow, although I also caution you that government borrowing is probably reaching, if not currently at, unsustainable levels, so you still want to be very careful with adding to deficits. Okay. And that'll bring me to another kind of take on the whole impact of government deficits on the economy, and this is going to be closely related to the crowding out argument. And this is a argument known as equivalence theory, or sometimes called Ricardian equivalence, after the economist David Ricardo, who I have right here asking the question, well, what about deficits? Here's David Ricardo, 19th century British economist. What about deficits and debt? That is, how are people going to react to increase in deficits? Ricardo's going to suggest that they're not going to passively sit around and wait for the effects of deficits to harm them, but they might proactively try to defend themselves. Okay. We're talking about debt tax equivalence theory, also known as Ricardian equivalence after David Ricardo. Okay. What we want to keep in mind is that deficit spending implies higher future taxes, okay, or future government budget cuts. Okay. Which, for reasons we'll address in later units, I'll explain, is very unlikely, at least in aggregate. Okay. So we're probably looking at higher future taxes in some form when government builds up massive deficit spending and builds up a big national debt. Okay. Ricardians, as I said, are going to say, well, people aren't going to passively wait around to get slammed by the higher future taxes. They're going to take proactive steps to protect themselves from that higher future tax burden. And basically what they're going to do is save more today to protect themselves in the future from the tax man. Okay. Well, we can see what the result will be. If people save more, that means they consume less. And bada boom, crowding out is happening. Okay. Crowding out will happen because of people's expectations change and people's behavior changes in expectation of what the deficits imply, which is higher future taxes. Now, I want to think about the Ricardian effect with an example I concocted with some pretty simple arithmetic that'll illustrate how this can play out. Okay, and I want to develop a situation where we have a person, a successful business person, let's say, graduated with honors from the Miller College of Business. You got an income of $200,000 per year. You want to bequeath $1 million to your heirs, let's say. And I'm imagining somebody who's maybe 50 years old and has arrived at the peak of his or her career and profession, earning nice money, paid off all the debts. Okay, you've paid off your student loans. You've paid off your house. You don't have a car payment. You don't have substantial bills. So now you're really ready to start saving serious money to build up some kind of legacy, some kind of retirement fund, whatever you want it for. And let's just say you have a 10-year time horizon over which you want to build up this fund, okay? And your current tax rate is 25%. Okay. Now we'll talk about what you'll do to build up that fund. But we're going to introduce a scenario in which a government embarks on expansionary fiscal policy and starts increasing deficits and building up a big national debt. This implies higher future taxes, and I'm going to presume that you expect that 5 years down the road, your tax rate's going to double in order for the government to take care of the deficit without resorting to inflationary finance. Okay. Let's think about before fiscal stimulus and the deficits, how you would go about building up your 1 million fund. Okay. Your gross income was 200,000. We have to take the 25% tax off of that, so that brings our net income down to 150,000. And ignoring the compounding, of course, with compounding you wouldn't have to save this much, but just to simplify, saving an equal amount for 10 years, say 100,000 a year for 10 years is going to get you to the $1 million. Your net income's 150,000. That leaves you 50,000 to live on. Can you live on 50,000 a year if you have no house payment, no debt? Of course, you can live quite nicely. I would suggest on 50,000 a year if you have no bills. So that's kind of phase one there. Now, phase two is where fiscal stimulus is happening and deficits are rising and you're expecting higher future taxes. Okay. If your tax burden's going to jump to 50% 5 years down the road, well, that brings your net income down to 100,000. You can't save 100,000 out of a net income of 100,000, can you? That leaves you zero money to live off of, unless you want to live in a van down by the river.
First off, I am 35 years old. I am divorced, and I live in a van down by the river.
Okay, and you can't save 100,000 out of a net income of 100,000. You're going to have to reduce the amount of savings in the final years. Now, to hit your target of building up the million-dollar fund, what that means is that you're going to have to save more in the early years, aren't you? You're going to have to save an extra sum of money in the early years. What we're going to realize here, and I'll show you this in a second here with a spreadsheet, is that we're going to have a $250,000 overall shortfall. The total tax hit is going to go up by $250,000. So what we're going to have to do is save up an extra $25,000 per year total over the 10-year span to just to make up, just to meet the higher expected tax burden. And here's the math. I think this will probably make a little bit more sense when I'll just show you it in the spreadsheet form. But what we'll find is that we have a perfect crowding out here. Let me go straight to the spreadsheet and I'll show you what I mean. First off, consider the situation where we had no deficit spending, so the tax rate stays at the constant 25% rate for the whole time. Okay. Your gross income is 200,000 a year for all 10 years. 25% tax rate takes 50,000 out, so your net is 150,000 for all 10 years, out of which you can easily save 100, adding up to 1 million. And you have what I call lifestyle here, personal consumption spending of 50,000 every year. Okay? Da-da-da-da. Now, take a look at the situation where the government builds up deficits. The tax rates stays at 25% initially, but it's going to jump up later. Okay, and just for simplicity, we're going to say it doubles. Okay. So in your years 1 through 5, everything's the same in terms of your gross and net income. Okay, but in year 6 through 10 here, your net income is down to 100,000. The tax hit is now 50%. Taxes are now wiping out half of your income. You can't save 100,000. You're going to have to ratchet down the savings. And I'll have you ratchet the savings down to 75K per year in the final years, which means your lifestyle's way down to 25,000. Okay. Not eating out as much, I guess. You're not driving in fancy cars, but you can still get by on this. Okay. To still generate a million-dollar fund, you can still do it. What you're going to have to do is replace the lost saving down here, which is 25,000 per year for 5 years, by saving more up here, an extra 25,000 a year for 5 years. And notice what you wind up doing is ratcheting down the lifestyle right now, ratcheting down the personal consumption spending, and that stays down for the whole 10 years. Okay, you're building the same fund, so you're generating the same amount of capital, you're consuming a lot less. Okay. And note, here's kind of the takeaway, here's the lesson. In order for total saving to remain the same, net income and lifestyle had to decrease by exactly the amount of the extra taxes. Okay, let's think about this in terms of our old y equals c plus I plus g. And what's happening here, for the government to spend more through deficit spending, consumption goes down. Okay, that's what's happening up here. What happened to investment? You might think, well, I'm saving more. You're really not saving more. You're just spending less. Okay, investment stays flat. How do we know that? Well, you've still built up only $1 million capital fund. Again, ignoring compounding. It'll wind up being more than this, but just for simplicity's sake, we'll take out the compounding. Okay, you have the same capital fund built up. Investment is flat. For government spending to go up, consumption had to go down. Result, crowding out. Okay. And what the Ricardian logic is suggesting here is you cannot escape the need to pay for government spending, ultimately in some form of taxation. So here's Ricardo reminding us that there's no such thing as a free lunch. Okay, moving on, I want to quickly address some other problems with fiscal stimulus. I think the crowding out and the equivalence arguments are going to be the most powerful ones, but there's a few others that bear mentioning, one of which will be fiscal lags. Okay, and the textbook defines this as a matter of timing. I want to note that fiscal policy is meant to provide a short-run boost to the economy, and it could be explicitly at the expense of the long run. Okay, you build up deficits, you have to have higher future taxes to pay them down, and that impairs future economic growth. Problem is, it takes time to implement, to work a fiscal plan through Congress, to implement it, to get the money flowing. And by the time it occurs, things could have changed. Aggregate demand shock could have reversed on its own. Okay, we could have positive supply shocks happening on their own. Okay, there's a lot of things that can change. And we have a possibility that the stimulus is no longer needed. It might not be effective anymore. Okay. And here's this, a whole bunch of lags we can think about. The problem has to be recognized. Legislation has to be approved. Legislation has to be implemented through a bureaucracy. Okay, money has to flow through the economy, and then it has to be reevaluated eventually. This can take potentially months, perhaps up to years. Okay. And we'll comment on that here in a minute. Now, another critique which is developed in the book is the fact that even a large stimulus program like the Recovery Act of 2009, $800 billion, that's going to be a tiny amount relative to overall spending, relative to overall GDP. Non-security discretionary spending, we're talking about government programs that aren't kind of on autopilot, so things that Congress can actually change, make large changes to in a short period of time. That's less than 20% of the federal budget. Okay, that's going to be a tiny amount of overall GDP. Here's the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act of 2009, stimulus, $800 billion worth. It's an awful lot of money, right? Well, consider a few facts. It's spread over 3 to 4 years. At its peak, that's only going to be about 2% of GDP per year, okay, because it's only going to be $200 billion or so per year. And what's it actually spent on? We talked earlier about how we ideally this would be spent on government purchases, things like building capital. Well, only 3% of the $800 billion went to spending capital. The president famously said the shovel ready wasn't quite as shovel ready as we had hoped. Okay. About a third of the stimulus went to temporary tax cuts. Temporary tax cuts are going to be saved and not spent, so whoops, not going to have a stimulus effect. Another third of it just went to propping up state government finances, which, okay, maybe that's a worthy thing if you're just interested in maintaining jobs. Of course, we can ask whether those jobs are really being productive or not. And the problem that creates is it makes the states dependent on federal largesse, which might not be a good thing in the long term for the state finances. Here's, you might have seen these signs, the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. This was the stimulus the stimulus program in 2009. And these signs went up all over the place with federally funded highway projects, which, as I've said, that's capital that could be some very productive government spending, building roads, building capital, and employing people to do so. That's the kind of stimulus, you know, that could be effective. I think the implication, you saw these signs all over the place on all kinds of highway construction projects and road construction, and you're thinking, oh, the stimulus is all about building roads. Well, it actually was mostly about other things. Okay, only 3% of it, as we mentioned, went to infrastructure. So it would be a little misleading here by the marketing efforts. Okay, finally, I want to come back to this recurring theme of the debt problem. Okay, fiscal policy implies deficits. Okay, deficits imply higher future taxes. Higher future taxes are going to be a drag on the economy. Okay, higher future taxes are contractionary fiscal policy. Now, remember that fiscal stabilization ideally is only supposed to be temporarily increase government spending to boost aggregate demand in times of recession. In times of good growth and prosperity, you're supposed to do the opposite. Okay, I don't think the politicians got that memo. You're supposed to go to budget surpluses. You're supposed to pay down debts. Okay. Here's the problem. Political incentives, which is going to be the focus of the next and final lesson in this unit, don't work that way. Politicians want to increase spending in bad times, and they want to increase spending in good times too. What that means is that fiscal policy is going to tend to give us continual deficits, and that's going to lead to a continually rising debt. You build up a big enough national debt, now you have big budget burden in simply paying the interest on that debt. Okay. Let me take you back to the current federal budget. Okay. Interest, 7% of spending, about $250 billion. That's at historically low interest rates, folks. Okay. Interest rates go back to kind of an average trend level over for the past 20 years. We're looking at doubling this. Okay, if we double interest, and that's disregarding the increase in the principal of the debt. Okay, we double interest. Notice $500 billion. That's on par with Medicare spending. Okay, we triple interest, which is not out of the realm of possibility. Now we're talking $750 billion. Okay, now we're talking about interest is approaching becoming the single biggest program, bigger than Medicare, bigger than Medicaid, bigger than welfare, almost as big as Social Security and military spending. Okay. Now, when you watch the video IOUSA, hopefully you've watched that already, they talk about this threat. They talk about the prospect of interest payments, Social Security, Medicare, and military spending by themselves eating up the entire federal government budget within a few decades. Okay. And at that point, that's the result of continual deficits, of continually overexpansionary fiscal policy. That is not healthy for the economy. Why? Well, okay. You actually get a situation where you build up too much debt, you can't meet the interest payments, you can actually have an economic meltdown. Okay. And there's a whole bunch of countries that have gone through this recently. Okay, recently, you might have heard about some of this in the news. Greece is still going through it right now. Argentina went through it about 10 years ago. What happens in these situations? Well, a country like Argentina is going to go through inflationary finance to pay off its debt. It's going to actually basically shut down its banking system. It's going to lead to something we call capital flight, massive disinvestment in this country because they're inflating the value of their currency away. If you have money in the bank and then inflation is inflating the value of it away, what do you want to do? You want to get that money out of the bank, out of the country. You want to convert your worthless Argentinian currency into something like dollars or gold, okay, or something like that. So what you see is a massive flight of capital out of this country. People don't want to invest there, in other words. So capital stock goes down, growth goes down. Okay. What's happening in Greece? Now, Greece can't use inflationary finance because they are beholden to the euro. They are exporting their monetary policy to mostly Germany. So they can't inflate their way out of their mess. So what do they have to do? They have to do austerity. Okay. Austerity, which means government budget cuts, which means declining declining aggregate demand, but if you have sticky nominal wages, which can't fall with other prices in the economy as aggregate demand declines, what are you going to wind up with? That's right, boys and girls, you're going to wind up with massive unemployment. Okay. Greece currently has an unemployment rate around the 27% range. Oh, for overall employment, for youth, we're talking people up to, I think it's 24, might be 25 years old, we're talking 50% plus. Okay. Greece is in an economic nightmare situation, and it's probably only going to get worse before it gets better. Okay. Why? Well, some pundits will blame it on austerity, too much budget cuts. Well, that's a proximate cause, but austerity, you need to note, is the necessary outcome of excessive debts and deficits in debt. Okay. Greece's problem is they borrowed way too much money. Their government borrowed too much money for too long. They built up debt that they couldn't ultimately refinance or pay off. So now they're in severe austerity and severe recession. The problem is the debt. Okay, so let me kind of wrap up this lecture by giving you a little chart that spells out what happens with excessive expansionary fiscal policy. Okay. Economy enters a recession, so we say, okay, we need to do fiscal stimulus, so we run up deficits. The deficits bring us eventually, if we don't, if we do perpetual deficits, that winds up giving us a large government debt. Okay. And a large government debt eventually gets us to the point where the interest burden becomes so large it chokes off other spending. Potentially the government can't refinance, interest rates go up, and you reach a fiscal crisis. Okay. There's two ways out: austerity, which means massive and painful government budget cuts, or inflationary finance. Pick your poison. Neither one's going to be really fun, and both can lead to economic chaos and catastrophe. Okay. All thanks to excessive fiscal stimulus policy, which brought us down this road to fiscal ruin. Okay, now, if that's not depressing enough, kind of when the next and the final lesson of this unit, I'm going to indicate to you why it's going to be extremely difficult, if not impossible, to cut government spending, and why I have a pretty firm expectation that the way out of our fiscal problem for the U.S. is going to involve pretty heavy doses of inflationary finance. We're going to focus on the politics of government spending, interest group dynamics, political incentives, and I'll teach you a little bit about what economics analysis has to say about the political process and government spending.